Outstanding. It's the ultimate accolade for teachers. We challenge primary teacher Steve Kubersing to go from good to outstanding. A top inspector observes one lesson. Two experts fine-tune his practice and beef up his presentation. He then gets 2 weeks to take on the advice before the inspector comes back for the final verdict.
I don't think it's easy to become outstanding because I don't think anything's easy. I think everything you want, you have to work for.
Springwell Juniors is a two-form entry school in West London, located under the main flight path of Heathrow Airport. Steve Kubersing is in his second year of teaching at Springwell.
OK, you're going to show him you got the skills?
To pay the bills!
Right.
The school rates his teaching as good.
Give me a number.
25.
Let's go.
10, 20.
One of the challenges for me is to just not get complacent and keep moving on with it and keep getting better and better. I am so fortunate to have children who just love learning. When you've got them engaged, learning is taking place. They're stimulated and they want to go with it.
At the beginning of the year, Mr. Kubersing said, "Who thinks maths is boring?" And I put my hand up. Now I've understood now it's like really fun the way we do maths.
What makes a good lesson is he doesn't just write it down on the board. He tells us what to do and then we can do it in a fun way.
Aside from the stresses and strains of end-of-term activities and a pile of reports still to write, Steve rustles up a Kubersing special.
About the observation next week, I most probably feel a little bit apprehensive because I think having anyone in a classroom, you always feel like you're on the spot a bit. Be interesting to see what they come back with, but I just really want to keep it the way it is. If I change anything, it's not going to be right.
It's the morning of the first observation with the inspector.
It's a Friday morning as well, which isn't the best time for an observation, but let's see how we go. I think once we get going, it flows, it will be fine, I think.
With hundreds of inspections under her belt, school inspector Claire Gillies leads inspection teams up and down the country. She certainly knows an outstanding lesson when she sees one.
I'm here to observe Steve teaching Year 3 numeracy. He's had this class nearly for the whole year now.
What will she make of Steve's Year 3 maths lesson? He's got 60 minutes to impress her.
6. Lots of.
6! Lots of! 3! Equals!
An accepted understanding of outstanding compared to good is that all pupils in a class have made at least the amount of progress you would expect in a lesson.
Are you going to take that?
No!
Inverse.
18 divided by 3.
One ingredient of an outstanding lesson is when the pupils are clearly completely absorbed and almost have a rapport with the teacher where they're studying together, they're learning together.
Ooh, look at you! Now, I need to find the location of the parrot. Shavestava, please, come on down.
First, we went like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. No, 6. And
6.
We went counted upwards, we saw 7. And then we came up with 6-7.
So we've got 6 and 7. That's interesting.
It's G7.
Tell me what you mean. Come on down, please.
I counted A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and it'll be G7.
So you said G7. OK. Can you now give me the coordinates of this parrot again using numbers and alphabet? You're going to sit back to back and you're going to plot coordinates. Remember, alphabet horizontally on the x-axis and the numbers on the y-axis, okay? Right, are you drawing, are you recording? No, you do exactly the same. It's supposed to be like a mirror. So for example, now draw a square in D6. Right, so you sat back to back. You weren't cheating. No. You didn't look at each other.
No.
Ooh, look at them. Excellent. They do look the same, don't they?
We had to shade in a square and we had to tell each other what to do. And then that's how I understood.
Right, we're going to be human coordinates. Do you think you can do that?
Yes!
Let's go. So, I want you to stand along that line horizontally, please. You are the x-axis. What are you guys going to be? Or some of you are going to be? Come here, coordinates. Come here, come here. Isam, you are going to go to spot C5. A, B, C, and... So, are you standing? Are you standing? Yeah, Gloria? Front of Gloria? Right. G10. Okay, and finally, D7. Well done. Come on, what are we waiting for? So, have a go at finding E3. Now, it's very difficult to see here. Who can have a go at finding E3 for me? Sarah? F1. Okay, let's see if she's right. Excellent. Right, A3. Mimi? F5. Okay, let's see if he's right. Well done.
So how did Steve get on?
Steve, thank you very much for letting me watch that lesson. I enjoyed it so much.
Good,
as did all the children, and that's the great thing, because I think it's clear that your generic teaching skills are just wonderful. And you just make everything fun, but we're learning at the same time.
Yeah, thank you.
And there were just a few little points. We did have a bit of letter and number confusion,
yes.
if we're honest. I wonder if we should have had a bold decision that we were going to be completely, for all of them, to start with letters and numbers and not get into numbers and numbers. Because I just wonder whether that's left a little, little tiny confusion for some of them. I think about half of them, and you picked this up, were a bit confused.
Yeah.
Having not understood the instruction whatsoever of sit with your back and make sure you have the same. It was sort of the table nearest the front of the class that was the more confused table, I think. Maybe a little more subtle pairing might have actually got them all, because I felt a good half had really got it. The others weren't quite so clear. And then, of course, this lovely, brilliant idea of rushing outside and being coordinates.
Yeah.
In the sense of making it fun, reinforcing in a different way, wonderful. It's a little but.
It's a bit risky, yeah.
So what did you think, if you were doing that little bit of the lesson again, how would you make it just that little bit more effective?
What I would do is actually, I would give them letters and numbers to hold.
Yes,
and it would make it a lot easier. We can develop this in another lesson. They would have numbers and letters.
Just a thought. Brilliant to come back to the rabbits going to the cinema again, because that's really good context.
Yeah.
But it would have just perhaps the real life element of why on earth are we interested in these coordinates?
Yeah,
it's the
really
old relevance context,
so
that they can see the meaning of it. And you know, then there's some of them might have gone home and got a map out, you know, one of those sort of map lying around in the car or something, and said, oh, we would, you know.
The first observation is behind him. The inspector highlighted Steve's need for context and greater clarity of intention. Now it's time to bring on the experts. To boost Steve's progress, help comes from communications coach Roger Terry and primary maths expert Darren Elsom. They start by watching Steve's lesson.
So what I'd like to talk with Steve about is, certainly getting his head around the learning journey. Where does this lesson fit in within a longer teaching sequence? But also I'd like to talk to him about modelling and demonstrating a bit more. I'd like to see more of him actually showing himself as the expert learner, the expert mathematician.
He's got a great rapport with children.
Oh, fantastic
rapport. In terms of engaging them, teaching them get so enthusiastic at being at the child's level that they kind of have to make that step back to being the teacher every so often and make that distinction. Well, welcome, Steve. So I thought one of the things we do straight off is work a little bit with the physiology to give you some sense of how you might become a bit stiller in the classroom to get some stillness. As when we're still, we can command attention, especially when we want to create focus on you. Okay, so Steve, what I'm going to do is just going to give you a shove and just notice how oh, that's okay. Good. Okay, so what I'd like you to do now is just put your hand over your belly button. I'm pushing you about three times as hard now. And how does that feel?
Yeah,
solid. So yes, solid. Standing up in front of the class with that solid, centered feeling puts you in charge, gives you quite a bit of presence. One of the other things I'm going to do is just help loosen your body up and help that voice resonance. And I'm going to get you to stand on this balance board. We're building you a new voice, mm-hmm. a command voice for you to use quietly, but with power. Think about how you might emphasize the things that you want them to do.
Now I'd like you all to put your books in the middle of the table. Line up. Quietly, please.
You can get off the balance board now. Yeah, you can. Unless you like being that high. So a little bit of practice with that, you start to be able to pace the class in a way that is a little bit more sophisticated than the way you've been doing it.
They said, if I counted seven up,
one of the things that we're looking at today is moving from good to outstanding, because actually the criteria for that's quite woolly. It's basically good with knobs on.
Right. Yeah.
It's good all of the time, plus more. Just have a look at this, see what you think.
First we went like this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then we came off with 6-7.
Is that what you did?
Yeah.
What was your thought then when he came up and basically blew the lesson out of the water?
I was quite pleased that he kind of got the concept of what we were going with. Mm. But I knew that he would, but there'd be plenty of others that still needed to go over that.
To make an outstanding, all children's learning has to move forward. Yeah. That's what firms it up from being good to outstanding. Yeah. And one of the ideas with that is knowing in your mind's eye the longer learning journey of this unit. Right, so for me, I think it's starting off with assess and review.
Yeah, mate. So what you're saying is take the first lesson and just basically elicit their knowledge and...
Absolutely, absolutely.
Where they're at.
Absolutely.
That
because that then gives you the starting point. And the next bit is not the lessons in between. You start thinking about where you want the children to be, the outcomes.
Yep.
The outcomes are about what you want the children to be able to say yes to at the end. I can do this, I know that, I understand this.
Yeah.
What we say in the lesson is we show these all the time. Right. At the beginning of the lesson, this is where we're working towards. Yeah. Oh, we can do that already. This is the next step. Yeah. And then for the lesson, you'd say, and this is the bit we're looking at today. Mm-hmm. So what it's doing is it's putting today's lesson within the context of the longer learning journey. Okay. So that's almost like the finishing line.
Yeah.
And only then can you start thinking about the steps in learning. Mm-hmm. Now, these aren't lessons. They're milestones in the children's learning towards that finishing line.
Yeah.
So if you've got the bigger picture and you've planned it through with that kid, you would have known that you've got something up your sleeve because you'd have already thought about it. Now, the inspector talked about rooting your lessons within a meaningful context, within a real-life context, and I think that's absolutely vital.
Yeah.
And what I try to do is to root the learning within the real world, take it to the maths world, and that's where you can do all of your games and your teaching and your learning, and then I have to bring it back to the real world again. Yeah. You could start off by saying, has anybody seen a map? Mm-hmm. Have you used a map?
Yeah?
So actually rooting it into a meaningful context. And then you could take the learning out into the maths world and bringing it back down again into the real world. What was interesting for me was that I was sort of desperate at one point to see you do a bit of teaching. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What you do is you get a lot from the children.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not talking about 20 minutes of didactic teaching, standing there at the front, you know, but 1 or 2 minutes of modelling and demonstrating the lesson to them, actually showing them the learning. So with the coordinates, right, guys, this is what the lesson's about. Let me just show you what I mean by coordinates, actually doing that, and then saying to the kids, right, so you have a go.
I also want to make sure that I don't inhibit the creativity, because sometimes I think if things are too prescribed, you don't allow for going with what the children feel, need, or are interested in. And I think if I stick to something too rigidly and forget about the children, I would be scared that you don't engage them anymore and then learning will stop.
But having that bigger picture means that you've got that framework, because obviously, yes, we do want to take the children's interest. We do want to take the learning from them and push them forward, but it's got to be done within a framework.
Sure,
we've got to make sure that we're driving along the same learning journey. Otherwise, we end up on a different motorway altogether.
I've just come out of this session and it's been quite a long day. And what I really need to do, I really need to think about this. Today has been, it's been an interesting experience. I think for me, I can just build on what I do, but it makes me feel like I'm going in the right direction.
So with Steve's final observation just weeks away, it's back to the classroom to put all that advice into action and raise his game.
What we're going to do today is we're going to be looking at planning the unit. Why do you think I've created this shop in the corner here? What do you think our unit's going to be and how will this help us?
I think we got that shop so we can learn about money.
When we've got our shop in the corner, what does it represent?
Real life!
Right, so now our maths becomes more...
Real life!
This is a kind of first time I've got to really trial out some things from the clinic. You know, the model that Darren talked about the real world, the maths world, and then going back to the real world. And that really kind of inspired me to create a shop. We're going to plan a party, OK? Our party. What do we need to do to get there?
We have to start buying food.
OK, right. What do we need to make sure we can do? Obviously, we need to add properly, OK? We need to do addition, so we need to do that. Remember, we're using money, so what do we need to know? Sarah?
Multiplication.
Multiplication, of course.
Division.
Right.
Percentages.
Percentages. Oh, there's a lot of things here. What was new for me was us planning the unit together. I kind of, you know, put a finish line, but I kind of bullet pointed, you know, things that we need to do. Now, all of us might not cover all of these things, yeah? But what we will do is we will have a tick list and see which ones we've covered. I think they will really be relating everything they do into a context, into something that's meaningful for them. That's really going to work well, and I think that's something that I will definitely, you know, keep doing. Here's the £1.28 at the bottom here, and there's my... Yeah, my £2 there. So, think about your multiples.
I had a 2.
Right. What's that going to get me to now? Kirit.
£1.30.
£1.30, OK. I've got... A lovely bunch of?
Bananas!
Right. And what I want you to do is show me, using the same method, my bananas are 47 pence, I've got £2, and I need to get some change. Right, can everyone show me their whiteboards now? Who did it in 3 jumps? Susie.
First, I added 3 pence.
First, she added 3 pence. What does that bring us to? 50 pence. The ideas that we discussed, Darren and I, are quite conducive with my style of teaching. The only thing that I always do is I always give it to the children. That's really important for me. I still wouldn't just stand there modelling to the whole class. I will do to aspects of it. However, I really think it's important for the children to keep thinking, keep thinking, keep challenging, keep thinking. Well done. Excellent for that. Thank you very much.
With Judgment Day looming, Darren calls to find out how Steve's getting on.
Hello, Darren.
Hi, Steve. How's things going?
What I found really, really useful and the children really enjoy it is the model that you said about real life, the maths world, and bringing it back to real life. And we've done that. We've actually incorporated. Now we've built a little shop in the corner. The unit that we're covering, it lends itself, we're actually going to have a party. So they really do see the finish line for them is built in with real life, because they really see the point of what we're doing and they're enthusiastic. And
they're all working towards this goal.
That's
together.
It.
Well, I wish you all the best of your
observation. Well, thank you very much, Darren. Thanks. And we'll speak again soon.
The day of Steve's last observation has arrived. Time to de-stress before the final verdict.
A little bit apprehensive about this one, more so than the last one.
I mean, I have done quite a lot of preparation in terms of being able to make the modelling and the children's learning move on. I've kind of developed these mission cards. These basically are a way of giving the children their individual learning intentions. Okay, this relates to our learning journey. We've got where we're going to start, the finish line, and these are our hurdles that we'll get over. But I've actually taken this literally. You'll see how it all comes together during the lesson. I don't want to spoil it for you.
Claire Gillies is back, and it's crunch time. With all that expert advice and weeks of practice behind him, will Steve have made it from good to outstanding?
Let's go.
100, 200, 300.
At the end, I will start to reflect on what was it the teacher was doing that made those pupils learn, that helped those pupils to enjoy learning, that helped them to want to be absorbed and involved.
Who's ready for the dots?
Yes.
Right, ready?
Yes.
Halve it.
Oh! What was it? Oh, yeah.
What was it?
Five.
Right. What have we been doing this week? Shrestha?
Money and real life.
At the end, at our finish line, we're going to have a party. What are these?
Hurdles.
Right. What sort of hurdles are we going to try and get over to get to the end? Rev? Addition. We will be looking at adding, won't we? Okay. If we're thinking about adding, what sort of language would we be using?
Total.
Oh. Wait, why is everyone saying ah? He said it right.
Yes.
That's it. I tell you what's really worked for me is I really like the idea of the moving the success criteria. Making the children aware, giving them ownership of what we're aiming for, the finish line, the journey.
I think the finishing line is good because it's like a reward for us. And it's like we've done all that work and then it's like there is no point of just doing it for nothing. So I think we should get a reward.
If you have a quick look on your desks, you'll have your mission cards. What I want to do today is to use many of the skills we've been learning throughout the past week to try and accomplish your mission. Would someone from this group like to read out their mission?
You are responsible for the cakes, juices and ice cream. You'll write a list calculating the total.
I think the mission cards work really well. That's a good way of differentiating the learning according to ability, so there isn't just one set learning intention. Okay, what's four fives?
Eight.
Four fives? Four times five? 20, okay. What's four times six? Right. And then four times eight?
32.
Right.
I could understand, like, you had to work out the price for 30 children because you were times them, but I didn't get the dividing bit.
What were the main operations that you guys used here? Addition. Okay. What were you guys doing over here?
Multiply and take away.
It's a little bit challenging, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes, it's challenging, but we need to keep going, okay? Yeah. Right, it is tricky at first, but what will it get?
Easier.
If I look at the lesson as a whole, there were some really super features there, some of which I spotted last time and some of which have sort of emerged this time. And there were some things that didn't quite work, that it was so ambitious.
Yeah, yes, yes.
And I mean, it's wonderful to have high super challenge and high expectations and all that, but perhaps it was almost just too much. Just looking at some of the specific strengths of the lesson, we got off to a lovely start with just the simple getting our hundreds, tens and units clear in our mind without and linked to the body movements. I just wondered whether we spent perhaps a little bit too long on the whole idea of the hurdles that we face, which is obviously brilliant for them to see that in coping with money in real life, because I think it then meant you slightly had to gather pace when introducing the different work for the different tables and just just adjusting the balance, would that have perhaps got us off to a more flying start?
For me and for them, I think we're embedding this idea.
I love the idea it's hard and it gets easier. Yeah.
And I think as we progress, you know, for another topic, I'll use the same format and we'll both get quicker at it.
This one here, I thought that by the stage of getting 7 packets of jumbo crisps for £1.25 was going to be given real, because they couldn't really work out what one packet cost. That challenged them quite a lot. You were expecting really high levels of thinking. And the compliment to your teaching and your rapport with them is how hard they worked. And that spirit of having a go, keeping going, is not something you can possibly generate in one lesson. You've generated that over time. So I don't think we can say the lesson was outstanding, but I think if we couple your definite outstanding skills with some really interesting developments in the relevance and, you know, how you're presenting materials, you're close to that, and I'm certain you're going to be hitting the outstanding lessons on many occasions. Thank you very much again for letting me share that lesson.
Thank you very much for coming to see us. Thank you. Two things I'd take away is make sure lessons relate to the real world. Put it in context. Bring it back to the maths world or literacy world, whatever, and then back to the real world. That's really important. And another thing I'd take away is don't go against the grain, your natural style. I think you gradually implement new ideas. If you try to shift too quickly, it just doesn't work straight away. And things don't happen overnight. And not every lesson can be outstanding. 3 things.